Last week, we broke ground on two major subjects, complex numbers and vector spaces. This week, we complete those construction projects by digging deeper into each and then bringing them together into a single masterpiece that will be our home for studying quantum mechanics and also doing quantum computing. Today, we talk about matrices. In this chapter's introduction, I try to motivate you by saying that matrices are going to replace the truth tables of classical computing as a description of quantum gates. But there's a larger issue at stake here. In order to make vector spaces useful, we have to be able to move vectors, transform bases, and generally do real computations. All of this requires manipulating and multiplying these things called matrices. So we'll begin by defining matrices as rectangles of numbers, then go on to learn a technique for multiplying matrices. A special case of this is the product of a vector by a matrix. In fact, this simple procedure is going to be exactly how the matrix acts like a logic gate capable of modifying the vector, which we're beginning to understand is our qubit. When the matrix multiplies the vector, the quantum gate is going to be transforming the qubit. But I'm getting ahead of myself. We need to focus just on matrices and vectors today and leave qubits and quantum gates for another time. You'll learn some essential vocabulary and also some pretty nifty moves. Taking the transpose of a matrix, using the ubiquitous identity and zero matrices, and also computing determinants. Determinants are probably the most computationally challenging. The concept is simple enough. Given a matrix, no matter how big, we can assign it a single number called the determinant. The determinant doesn't retain all the information of the original matrix. After all, it's a single number, and the matrix that produces it might have 10 rows and 10 columns, and therefore consist of 100 numbers. But it does tell us something important about the nature of that matrix. In particular, we're going to want to know whether the determinant is zero or non-zero. Hold that thought for a moment while I mention another aspect of matrices, the matrix inverse. Now, inverses aren't that hard if you think about simple numbers. Say you give me the number 3 and I want to construct another number that will multiply 3 to get 1. I'll, of course, pick 1/3. If you give me minus 37, I'll pick 1 over minus 37. In fact, for any number you give me, I can find a second number that combines with yours under multiplication to produce 1. Any number, that is, except, of course, 0. If you give me 0, I'm, well, let's just say toast. Same with matrices. You give me a matrix, and I try to find a second matrix called the inverse that can be combined with yours using matrix multiplication to produce the identity matrix. If I can do that, I've found the inverse of your matrix. Problem is, most matrices don't have inverses, but there's a trick we'll learn to find out which do. A matrix has an inverse if and only if, drumroll please, its determinant is non-zero. We'll end this short chapter with an optional technique based on a famous result called Cramer's rule. Cramer's rule tells us how we can use matrices and determinants to solve systems of simultaneous equations. If you've ever heard phrases like, we have three equations with three unknowns, or the number of independent equations has to equal the number of unknowns, you're hearing someone talk about systems of simultaneous equations. Now, Cramer's rule isn't the usual technique for solving these systems, but it is beautiful, concise, visual, and even gives us a little preview of one of our upcoming quantum techniques, Simon's algorithm, where we have to solve some simultaneous equations of our own. This is a feel-good chapter, because with less than an hour's worth of practice, you can become proficient at multiplying small 2x2, 3x3, or even 4x4 matrices by hand. And nothing gives one a sense of progress like learning how to compute.